This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. Whether you're a beginner or a seasoned professional, No Wave Academy is your ultimate educational resource to help bring your artistry to the next level. Our renowned roster of instructors include Nick Runge, Mia Bergeron, Sean Cheatham, Kate Zambrano, David Chaffetz, Paul Christina, John Wentz, and many more. Some of these artists have appeared on this very podcast, while others have been featured in exhibitions at the No Wave Gallery and museums around the world. Here at No Wave Academy, we believe that everyone has a unique artistic expression. With guidance, experience, and the proper tools, students have the ability to invigorate and elevate their work. Unlock and unblock your inner creative voice. Join us and walk into the next chapter of your personal artistic evolution. Go to nowaveacademy.com. Type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. That's NOHWaveAcademy.com. Now, onto the episode. Hey everyone, this is your host Yoshino. You're listening to Artist Decoded. My guest today is multidisciplinary artist Damon Davis, and you might have seen his work as co-director on the critically acclaimed documentary film, Whose Streets, which chronicles the killing of Michael Brown Jr., an 18-year-old black man that was fatally murdered by the 28-year-old white Ferguson police officer, Darren Wilson, in Ferguson, Missouri. It then documents the subsequent social uprising that occurred throughout Ferguson in 2014. The first part of the interview, we talk about the documentary and racism in America. And right before this conversation, I watched the documentary, and to be honest, I was viscerally affected by it. And it's currently on Netflix if you'd like to watch it. And Damon also has a show coming up entitled Filling in the Cracks, which is at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Detroit. It just opened on June 4th, so if you're in the Detroit area, you should definitely check it out. He also has a show coming up entitled Darker Gods at the Lake of Dreams, which is at Betty Ono Gallery in Oakland, California. The show opens on June 18th. Thanks again for tuning in. Be sure to check out our YouTube page for some additional content, including full episodes, artist advice, and video clips from our interviews. We also appreciate the support if you go to our iTunes page and leave us a review. Anything helps, so please do so if you can. So here it is, my conversation with artist Damon Davis. Hope you enjoy it. Well, thanks for taking the time to do this. You know, I appreciate you for taking this time. And like I was saying, I was taking a deep dive into some of your work, and I watched Whose Streets, and yeah, that documentary was, man, it's super impactful, and it's such an important documentary. And it's really sad to understand, you know, everything that happened with like the killing of George Floyd last year. And it almost like identically parallels in a lot of ways. Although with Mike Brown, there was no justice for Mike Brown, you know? So I just felt very moved by that documentary.
Yeah, I appreciate that. And it happens over and over again, right? These are just the ones where people got pissed enough to take to the streets. But it ain't new to this generation. It's not new to, you know, it's just not new. It's old. It's an old, old problem, at least problem for us.
Yeah.
It ain't a problem for the people doing it. You know what I'm saying? It would have been changed by now. You know what I'm saying? So,
you know, now that it's been a couple of years since you've done that documentary, like, what do you think about it in terms of, you know, everything that happened last year, but also just how there's a continuance of that narrative that has been happening for years and years and years throughout history. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know what to think, you know. If anything, I would say that I'm not surprised, you know, like the older I get, honestly, the less hope I have for humanity. And that can sound, and I don't know if hope is the right word, but I'm less and less tied to these myths. Like I'll be talking about these myths of good people that realize they're doing bad things, or people actually love each other and are like, you know what I'm saying? These stories we tell each other and we tell ourselves about the society we live in so that we don't feel like horrible people for not giving a fuck about each other. I don't know, man. It's I want to think that people figure things out without violence and without their personal lives being at stake, but I ain't seen many examples of that in history where people just figure out that the way they've been, people in power figure out that the way that they've been going ain't the way to go. Because if you're in power, that's what you want to stay there, and it must be working if you're in power. You know what I mean? And
Yeah.
so but for black people or people that are of any other race that are under attack from ideas of white supremacy or colonial ideas or capitalism or whatever it may be, whatever the diagnosis you want to make on it, I just don't see it clearing up anytime soon, just by the grace of God or people in power having an epiphany that they should stop treating people like shit. I think it's gonna get a lot more for things to actually shift. I think it's gonna get a lot more ugly before it gets better, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I used to be a lot more hopeful at a younger age about us being able to talk to people and being able to express empathy through speaking or through showing things with my artwork. And at this point, I don't think it's my ministry to try to teach white people that these basic things that seem very basic to me about it's just empathy, teaching you how to be a human being. At the point that I'm at right now is I'm trying to make work to speak to the people that's under attack, to whether to fortify them, to give them hope, to keep going through life. The same though, and that's what Hoosiers is about. That these things, and to validate the story of those people so that they know that they're not crazy, because society have you thinking you crazy because it's set up a certain way, but it's not. It's not, and you got to become crazy to be okay with that shit. You know what I'm saying? And I think a lot of us going to a willing collective psychosis around the way we watched, and it's kind of like, if it ain't you, then you okay, because it's always coming for you, you know. And so I think it's a, but it's something about us. We enter into a social contract for us to be okay with this shit, but this shit is absurd, and it's irrational, right? But we beat ourselves into it mentally, telling ourselves that this is the way the world is and stuff like that. But it don't have to be, and it isn't. Yeah, it's just, this ain't normal. The normal that we got, it ain't normal, right? And so the people that they at the short end of the stick be needing something to make to keep their sanity in an insane world. And I think artwork can tell stories that can fortify the human spirit. And I think I'm personally in a place where that if there's anything that my art is actually doing other than making me happy, you know, and being my own personal thing. If it's doing anything in conversation with people, I hope that's what it's doing is fortifying the people that's being harmed. And I'm not concerned with teaching the perpetrators how to be civilized and shit to a degree, you know. It's just not in my,
Yeah.
yeah, it's that's not what I'm worried about, you know. And I do think somebody needs to do that. But I don't think I got the energy to do that right now. You know what I mean? I don't, it just ain't my ministry. So
Yeah.
I'm much more worried about my people and giving them something that some soul food that could keep them going throughout the day when all is madness.
it's almost become normalized, right? The insanity has almost become normalized, right? And I mean, you can bring this back down to capitalism and people that are in power, and it protects people in power. And because those people are in power, it's like there's no incentive to be able to, I mean, sorry, I'm trying to contextualize this, but it's also like,
what you want to say, and you can say it. Why would you give up? Who has ever given up power? Like giving it willingly to anybody. When we talk about the history of the modern world, no, that's not how revolutions act. That the revolutions don't occur bloodlessly. And that's being taught to you or to me and you by the people, and like how they act, right? Like how they act all over the world. Because that's the language of the Western world, is violence first. Whatever story we want to retell after it didn't happen, but when things happen, when things move, it happens violently. That's how the Western world deals with things. That's how they come into places. And alluding back to another thing you were saying, is like it's been happening for so long. And what I was hearing from you is like, it ain't that it's almost normal. It is normal. It is what this country says is normal, right? But that does not mean that there isn't a world where it didn't exist. Like, it happens often that motherfuckers think that it's the way, it's the universe. You know what I mean? Like that it's the universal law. And that's what they tell themselves, that this is like the sun and the sun going down and coming up in the morning. It's part of the fabric of time and space and shit. And not like it was, it's made up construct that we can date, you know what I'm saying? Like that there was time before people thought like this. So it ain't that fucking old, you know what I'm saying? Like it ain't that old and it ain't that in stone. It's a very fragile thing. And that's what, and they know that. The people that are invested in that idea for their own personal power.
Yeah, know? No, definitely. And it was interesting. I mean, there is that, I think I'm still a little bit shell-shocked from that documentary because it's such an emotionally pervasive documentary and it's super important. And I feel like a responsibility to be able to, you know, give you the space to like talk about, you know, to talk about your work, to talk about your story. And I think I'm just like very affected by that, which is good. Which is good,
mean,
right?
It was supposed, that mean it worked then. You know
Yeah.
It worked. That's the biggest compliment anybody can give me is you don't know what to say. If you knew what to say and it was easy and you was ready for it. So that means it puts you somewhere that took you somewhere else and now you're processing it. And that's the point of it, you know, at least for people that ain't back to what I was talking about, trying making it for the communities that are affected by this stuff. We know that this shit is going on. We know it's happening. So what it's doing for us is validation. But for people that don't find themselves in these positions every day, though I'm not making it for you or talking to you specifically, which is the beauty about art. You don't know who, once it's out in the world, you don't know who's going to interact with it. But if it's something, if you're tapping into it, it's intrinsically human. It ain't about a fad. It's based on something that, you hit a universality that you wasn't even aiming for by going micro and keeping it local and keeping the story very specific. You tell a macro story because it's relatable to people no matter where they are, if they got a certain level of self-awareness and they got empathy in their heart. You know what I'm saying? It's going to affect you whether you thought it was or not, whether you came in for that or not, whether I meant to do that to you or not. If the story is told, if we're talking about sadness, if I can tap into the core of that, it don't matter where you from or where I'm from, or who the main character was or what they look like, you gonna understand sadness because you got something that happened to your life that is somehow relatable to whatever the events is in the story. And that's basically what I was trying to say, is like if I just tell my truth and I keep it real, it's gonna hit other people no matter what.
You know? Well, I mean, going back to the, you know, the macro that you're talking about too, it's like, it's, yes, it is a race issue, right?
Yeah.
But it's also, I mean, the main point is like, it's a humanitarian issue.
Yeah.
Right. And I think that, you know, Black people in America have been for centuries, you know, have suffered from these various laws that have been put in place and, you know, these systems that have been put into place. And I mean, even in the beginning of that film, it was talking about around Ferguson and the conjoining cities around Ferguson, how like there was that scene in the car when they were talking about like, how are parents supposed to teach their kids certain things in school when they don't know how to read themselves, right? And then I think you said, if you don't know how to read, you're a slave. And I was thinking about that, and in terms of just
that's literally the definition, and that's what it is. That's what that was a part of. Without information, you're not available for choices. If you don't have information, you don't get choices. That's about it. You know what I'm saying? And it's a purposeful thing, you know. But yeah, I do, and I do want to let you know, like, I made that movie 3 years ago, 4 years ago, and I did it for a specific reason, for specific people, and for a specific time in my life. But that's not what I'm doing today. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I do want to talk about the other things that I'm working on, because it's made for the same people, but it's also like, That movie, it's for St. Louis, and in some regards it helps us out, but also some things that I just can't get around is that it's still a place where society is comfortable seeing us being hurt, brutalized, traumatized, and that's what everybody always want to talk about, right? How bad it is for fucking Black people. Like I know about, like, I don't know where I grew up at, and like that all of the rest of the Black people don't fucking understand what's going on in America. And then when other people catch up to it, the real thing to me is that why didn't you know that? Do you not know any Black people? How can you close your, how can it not be in front of you? So I mean, you can live a life where this does not affect you, right? Or at least in your mind, it doesn't affect you, because for somebody to be on top and for you to have a life where you ain't getting shot at by police or whatever, or police ain't harassing you, for you to live in a neighborhood, them police is harassing somebody. So you benefiting from the shit that's happening to us. But it's this thing in America that we got this amnesia thing, right? Like in the 90s, people, Rodney King people, we was talking about this. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like every 20 years, there's an uprising about this. And then for some reason, now even with the internet, the media cycles even faster. So you would hear about it and then you could go back to work. But the mother, the kid don't just go away for her.
Yeah, it just doesn't end.
You know, like it don't. Yeah. Yeah, it don't end when the credits start rolling on my movie for the Brown family. You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah, they'll be affected by that intergenerationally for years and years and years.
Forever. Forever. For as long as the people that knew him is alive, they gonna remember what happened and long past the news cycle. So it's just like it needed to be made, and we did a thing that was good, but also we need to make shit that uplifts Black, like not up. I hate that fucking cliche, uplift the people. Where we need some shit that
adds nuance.
Yeah, that speaks to another aspect of Blackness. What, like, that's the only thing. Like, motherfuckers are super comfortable watching us get beat the fuck up all the time and not doing anything about it. Like watching it for their entertainment, listening to it in their records, and not saying anything about it. Right, because you can go on with it's entertainment to you, but it's our actual lives and shit. And so what I'm trying to do now is, like, I want to build the world that I want to live in. That's what Darker Gods is about. That's what that's the shit I'm making, because I know what this world is. I'm very aware of it. I've been the same color my whole life, you know, like I was born here in this shit. So I'm not confused at all. And I'm not surprised. And that's what I mean. Like when you was like with the question you asked me about, like, how do you feel now, years after? I feel the same way I felt when I did it. I feel the same way I did at 15 when police was pulling me out of my car, harassing me and shit. Or not 15, I was a little too young. About 18, you know, like when I first started driving and shit. Like, you feel what I'm saying? It's been here for me and it's gonna be here for me. That's the reality of what's going on. It ain't gonna end. It ain't like I get butterflies and then I feel like I should do something and then I tweet and then I'm done with it. Like, no, this is just the everyday for me. You know what I'm saying? So what can I do with that surreal reality? I can make up another one and try to, and that's the thing the artist got. That's a superpower, is that, yeah, I could just be a scribe and tell you what's going on. I could be the news, and that's important. But I also could show you a world that don't exist yet. Hmm. Like the same principles of sci-fi. The same principles, like I can show you the world. I can help build out the world that I want to live in. And I think that's where my heart is right now in my practice. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, definitely. But I think that's what's beautiful about what you're doing too, is that you're showing the multiple layers and the complexity, including the history, but also the complexity of blackness in America, right? And you're showing I mean, also, you know, some of your conversations, like I was talking to you about, you know, when you, with your podcast, the Damon and Damon podcast, on that podcast, you're talking about grief and you're talking about the loss of your mother and the loss of your friend Damon's mother. And, you know, and I think that from that, I mean, that also talks about masculinity and how masculinity is viewed within our society as well. And what does that mean? Yeah. What does masculinity mean for a man in our society? Right. So I think that there's like all of these, you know, things that you can draw from, whether that's from the myths that you've created for darker gods, you know, even talking about trauma with your project over at Filling the Cracks, or sorry, it's called Cracks.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And,
yeah. And that, well, and Filling the Cracks, I get, well, that's a good, that's a, that is the, that's the show that's going to be up in Detroit, but it is the Cracks series. And those things, black people worry about that shit too. It ain't just all about fucking police. Like it's like, you know what I'm saying? Like we have families and people get sick and die. And we go through grief, and it ain't always, white people ain't always at the fucking center of the story. You get what I'm saying? Whether it's good or bad, like we are human beings with our own autonomy, and we are living, and we, in the same way that whatever the fuck, you know, directors like Woody Allen, first person that came to my mind, you know, as a disclaimer, but can make movies are just about walking or fucking around, you know, or Jerry Seinfeld means absolutely nothing. Yeah. This shit means absolutely nothing at all.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
But when I got to tell a story, it gotta be filled with fucking wild car chases, trauma, drugs, death, and like a specific type, you know, a specific type of grieving, not just like regular family, or just regular relationship shit. We actually live through,
No, totally. I mean, if you want to like pick apart some cinema too, it's like, you know, you look at like Ryan Coogler, right? And you look at Fruitvale Station and what that story is about. And then, you know, speaking of Woody Allen, I mean, Woody Allen, you know, has been essentially a known pedophile within the film industry, right? And he's like glorified, right? So how is that? I mean, that's just shows the power.
But it also highlights what we talked about from the beginning. It highlights the differences, like the contradictions, the fucking the hypocrisy of what America is. This myth of the American dream, it does that with me having to have to hit you over the head with, you know,
with
the street story, black, you know, like, and that shit is important because that people exist in that, but there's other lives that is encompassed by blackness that I don't think we get to talk about as much, different point of views and shit like that, you know?
Yeah, no, totally. Yeah, totally. And yeah. And then, you know, something that you're bringing up is, you know, I think about also just like the values that we have in society, right? Like what is valuable in the society? What is something that is highlighted within the society? And then I think of like, you know, Crazy Rich Asians, for instance. And it just like, I mean, yeah, I think it's important to have Asian people in the mainstream in cinema. I think that's important, But at the same time, it's highlighting capitalism and people are glorifying capitalism, you know? So it just kind of, it's kind of like, okay, so what do we really value in society, right? And, you know, and we can draw parallels between all of these things, but then also I don't know exactly, I don't have the figures right here, but I know that that film made multi millions of dollars. And then I think of like what stories are actually going to push us forward, what stories, what narratives push the you know, push our culture forward as a whole and humanity forward as a whole, right?
No, I think that's a great, I think Crazy Rich Asians is a great example of assimilation, right? These ain't the values historically of African people, of people, of Asian people, of people from India. These other countries, these other places that are thousands of years old, right? Much older than a lot of the history that we get taught. Their intrinsic values was different before this system was imposed upon them, right? And so then it's like, we talking positivity, but the idea of positivity is being like them, right? Like you know what I mean? Like just like when we talk about rappers, it's all about money, but all it is getting you closer to what you think freedom is, which is whiteness, right? And so like when we get to talking about that shit, that's just indoctrination into like you cool, you get to be in our club, but it ain't changed. It ain't a different narrative. It ain't a different take on it. All you doing, like representation ain't always the best thing. If all you doing is swapping me out for a rich white dude that gets to walk around and shit on everybody and be an asshole, so I get to do it for a day, and now I'm a full human being. But are you? Is that any different? Why is that our standard? It just looks like assimilation. It ain't. You could have made that like it's movies like that, but they do that with like. It's a black version of that movie. You dig what I'm saying? It's a black version of Crazy Rich Asians. Yeah, and you know what I'm saying? But all you doing is swapping out. You're just putting us in the place of white people. It ain't no nuance. It ain't a different way of telling a story. It ain't nothing crazy. It's just extravagance.
That's also why I thought that Moonlight, for instance, was such an important film.
Yeah.
During that time.
I agree.
Time, I think was that like a couple years ago? Yeah, during that time. Yeah. It just, everything moves so fast now.
So
it just, pre-pandemic films.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
But I do agree. I do agree. That's something that I had never seen on film or in life. Like I ain't been around. Like Miami, like it's just like it was so, but like I was saying, like the detail of it is what makes it's weird. Like you would think that would make it less universal, but the details of it and the story and the performances and these things to speak to a story that to people that have no experience in can't relate in lived experience with the characters, right? And, yeah. And so that shows a different side of blackness. It adds to the complexity of black people. And I think inadvertently, if you get to see black people or Asian people, like or whoever doing something that you ain't never seen them do, that by proxy is adding complexity to the human race, the conversation of the human race, right? So that means that these one people like the only people that do this. So that means it's leveling the playing ground to a degree. So the same way, I guess I'm contradicting myself, the same way I'm talking about representation ain't always good, it ain't always bad either. You know what I'm saying? It all depends on how you do it. If you're gonna tell me something different about people that adds to the, like, I think film is a language, and I feel like it's a talk. And so if I ain't saying nothing that you ain't never heard, why am I talking? You know what I'm saying? If I don't got nothing to say, why am I talking?
It's a film, it's a language, and it's also a business too, right? So you have to think about, okay, so who's in power? I mean, this goes back to the whole power argument, right? I mean, it's not really an argument. It just, it's a thing.
You're right. It is what it is.
Yeah. So who are the executive producers making these films? Who is the studio making these films? And then, you know, people are monetarily incentivized to continue making these films, which continues that sort of narrative mm-hmm. going forward, which talks about the cultural values of America. But it's like, how can we continually inject nuance into the conversation? And then going back to, you know, some of the mythology between but behind Darker Gods, like I'm curious too, because you were talking about adding nuance into the conversation of blackness. Mm. And I'm curious what some of your ideas were behind that.
I think that, it all goes back. We keep using the word power because that's what it's about, right? And so like when I was thinking about, it initially started as like, why don't people see us as whole people? Because if you saw me as a whole person and you could see me the way you see yourself, then you wouldn't be okay with death. It's just like, if everybody had to butcher their own meat, most people would be vegetarians. You feel what I'm saying? You ain't got the stomach for, you know, you ain't got the stomach this to is do true. What it takes to for this byproduct. But because streamlined the evil, then you don't got to deal with it. So you can sleep at night and you can still enjoy the fruits of this traumatic thing. Right. Yeah. And so I started there and then just by interrogating the idea, it came clear to me that it's about power, and in a way, it's the narrative therapy of it all. Like if you tell a new story, you can empower people. If you tell them a new story about themselves, where they win, or win or lose, but they just got autonomy and control and self-awareness around something, it can shift the way they interact with the rest of the world. And so what's the most powerful thing you can think of? For me, or me, what was the most powerful thing I could think of? God. That is that word, those two words are synonymous. They mean the same thing, power, right? And so it's like, well, let's make up some that look like me and don't look like another person that I know and encompass these different aspects of human beings that are black, right? And I also really like how mythology tells you something without telling it to you. You know what I mean? That you telling the truth through a lie, basically, is like the story and parables and these sort of things work to tell you intrinsic truths about the human condition. Right. And it's been working for thousands and thousands of years. So it's like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But I can add something to this conversation by talking from my perspective and also from the perspective of people around me, listening wholeheartedly, taking in what I hear from people that I love and respect and working them into the story, too. You know what I'm saying? Making the average way, way above average. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely.
Until it's deified, you know?
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there is a reason also why Greek mythology and like biblical mythology, for instance, they hold certain psychological truths that, I mean, you know, you can look at Greek mythology and how that resonates within Hollywood films such as Star Wars. And I mean, you can also take, you know, George Lucas' Star Wars back to like Joseph Campbell. But it's interesting how there's these various mythologies that kind of like build on each other and they really point back to psychology and human psychology, right?
Yeah.
But I was curious too, because you mentioned power a couple of times, and I'm curious what your vision of like when you think of power and like a powerful version of yourself, for instance, like what does that look like to you?
I think power is, you know, everybody be like, I don't care what nobody think. That's a fucking lie. Every time I hear it, there's no way that a human being does not care what other people think. But there is a place I want to believe that I'm so confident in myself, or I care so much about, I got enough esteem and love for myself that I don't let it affect me and take me out of who I am, right? I feel like that's power. Hmm. I feel like, and I don't think it's as simple as saying I don't care what people think. I'm saying like there's a way to power is not letting what people think affect you and your idea of yourself and your level of love for yourself. You feel what I'm saying? And yeah, and you don't have to step on other people to do that.
You know,
like, you don't go, oh, go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, no. I was just kind of going to continue what you were saying.
Yeah.
But I wrote this down the other day, and I think this is relatable. So like a lot of people that listen to this podcast know that I have a background in martial arts. I've been doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for years and boxing and Muay Thai and all that, you know, all that stuff.
Word.
And I wrote down, I've spent all of these years training and fighting only to realize that strength is not always what you see on the surface. It's also what you embody internally.
Yeah. I think martial arts is amazing at that dichotomy of what true power is. Like, I could fuck you up right now. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we outside, you were clearly pushing me into an anger zone. And I know that I could physically overpower you because I have learned how to do that. But the real power is keeping that together. Like keeping yourself together.
Totally.
The power is the calm inside of yourself. And like, and I think that's true power. I think that I'm so kind, like, I know that I could do this, but I don't have to. That's also wisdom too. So you know what I'm saying? A child with power or all powerful reacts differently than like an elder with a certain amount of power, you know? And I think that what I want, if the most powerful sense of myself would be me just being able to take roll contentment, roll with the ups and the downs, and not let it stop me in my tracks, man. And I think like that's the most basic thing, and I think everything else grows out from that. So if I got money and I got that, then money won't change me in a way where I'll be, you know, or in a way where I'm out here hurting other people. Like, I would still be aware and still empathetic to people because I'm empathetic to myself. A lot of that shit starts right in the inside. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I think that's my idea of power. It ain't attached to material stuff. It ain't because I know that those things don't feel holes inside of you because, you know,
yeah.
I just. So it's like my thing is power in here. And that's what I'm working towards to get that, and I think that's just a journey that I'm gonna be on for the rest of my life. And I think, I mean, everybody. I don't think I think if you're not growing, you're dying. You know what I'm saying?
I totally agree. Yeah, I think there's a lot of power and control and restraint, understanding that you can take a situation and escalate a situation to a level of violence, or you can try to subvert that and to talk it out and have a dialogue and be able to control yourself in that manner, you know? But I do think it takes a lot of wisdom, and I don't think anyone's too wise to constantly need certain reminders too. You know, I mean, I'm constantly trying to like work on myself, and I mean, I can tell that you're a person, you know, that does that as well, you know, and, you know, even just reading like a book that comes to mind is like the Tao Te Ching. You know, I've read the Tao Te Ching like, I don't know, four or five times, multiple times, and it just keeps on giving me new information. And the more that, and it's interesting, like just artwork in general, the more that you, I mean, good artwork, the more that you come back to it in later points of your life, you can extract different meanings from it, things that you didn't see because you had blinders on, right? Yeah. And that's something that empathy does to you as well, is that the more that you have empathy, I mean, the more that you feel, I mean, that film that I was watching, I mean, it was, you know, it's I don't know, it's hard to put into words, right? And then I think also it's like, how desensitized we've become by seeing images of Black people getting killed, like through the media, you know, and that is just a constant reoccurrence, man, that happens all the time. And then it's like, you know, me being Asian American It's like I have a certain sense of privilege because I can kind of separate myself from that, right? But I think if you're truly an empathetic human being, then you'll want to lean in and try to help the cause in some capacity, whether it's just listening to people.
I agree.
I don't know. It's just, I'm not trying to draw conclusions or anything here. It's more so just trying to excavate for more questions, right? More trying to understand the nuance, you know, like you're saying with, you know, your new artworks and everything, just excavating and understanding the nuance of everything. Right.
Yeah. And when you was talking about the desensitized part, it makes me think of another body of work, an older body of work that I did called Negro Fear. And that was while Ferguson was going on. And like, that was when like, I'm going out and I'm doing protests, but I'm coming back. And it's like, I think at that point, that's when the sharing of Black death via social media begins and really, it really starts to saturate timelines. And so it's like, and you think that you're, and this is me saying this, I'm thinking that I see somebody get shot or like when they start getting footage of it, right? And you think by sharing it that you're bringing awareness, right? Or that you're helping something. But I think after a while, it's only hurting people because it's like now you can't get away from the trauma. Like you can't, like whenever you're talking, like you open your phone and it's person after person posting the same thing about human being being killed. And at some point it ain't helping neither side, because it ain't helping Black people, because it's just reinforcing that, okay, because they don't go to jail. They just not going to trial. They just not taking these motherfuckers to trial, but there ain't nothing happening to them. So it's just reinforcing the fact that your Black ain't don't mean shit to these people and to the rest of the world. And now it's entertainment to a degree, because it's like why, like, and then for whoever, you know, white America, the white people, the people in power, it's desensitizing. It's desensitizing everybody. And the thing is, it's desensitizing everybody. But you the one that could get shot. You feel what I'm saying? Like, it's desensitizing you to your own death. It's showing, it's reinforcing to everybody that we don't matter that much. And it's like, you think you're doing something good, but after a while, it's so much of it. And it's like, it's overwhelming, you know? And I don't think it's healthy for us to be watching that shit run over again. I don't think it's respectful to these people that's been murdered in these horrible ways to be showing this shit like this. That's how you gonna remember. You didn't even know me before this and it, but this is gonna be your memory of me. It's just like, but then it's like, if you don't do it, then you just get killed and you forgotten. So it's so, man, it's just such a complex, it's such a complex thing. So that's what I was with this body of work, Negrophilia. I wanted to talk about that phenomenon. Like it's a fucking fetish of our death, and it's something very specific to internet culture, right? And or it's specific to social media. And so like, just you bringing up like the desensitized part, I saw that in real time, and then I started drawing out these snapshots, these little 6x6 pieces. I ended up with like 130 of them, I think, just snapshots of what I was seeing out there, what I was going through, just me processing the idea that it's mainstream news that people are getting killed like this. And this ain't a movie, this ain't an action film. It's just like, these is real people we watching. So this can't be, for the collective consciousness, this can't be healthy mentally for us to be doing this. You know what I'm saying? And totally. Me just trying to, dissect that through the art. Like I do everything else, trying to get my thoughts together through the art.
Yeah. Yeah. I wonder about that too. It's like, how do you rise above that noise? How do the things that are super important, the conversations that are super important, like how do you rise above all of the sort of the clutter, right? And I think that technology has made us ADHD to an extent, and Yeah, I don't know. It's just super interesting to like think about.
It also and like it's supposed to add empathy. You know what I'm saying? By us sharing these things, it's supposed to add empathy. But I think the more and more you expose to something, you're losing the empathy. You know what I mean? Like you're losing the empathy whether that was the intent or not. You know what I mean? Like
Yeah.
it all becomes noise. The most important things and the meaningless things is all mashed up.
I'm gonna draw a parallel between like fighting, for instance. So like, me and my girlfriend, we have kind of totally different like views on fighting, because since I do it, it's kind of like I'm super desensitized with like seeing people get punched in the face, basically, right? And then, she's very affected by it, and just thinking about just the desensitization thing, and then, just I think about that in terms of whether you're aware of it or not, how much you put yourself in front of that thing and become desensitized by it, and then how like some people are, I mean, like I consider myself a critical thinker, right? But I think it's just like, I guess I'm okay with, maybe it's because I do it and I understand like self-defense mechanism behind it, and the sort of like the visceral ingraining that you put yourself through in your brain to be able to overcome those challenges, right? But it's just interesting to think about how like there's different people that live in sort of like different realities, and then you think about that in terms of like ethics, right? And how no and how a lot of people can't agree on like what is ethical in our culture, right? So I don't know, just more questions to ponder upon. Yeah.
And it's all exposure, I think. A lot of it is exposure. I think that I wouldn't the self-awareness that I got or empathy that I got for other people that of different backgrounds, races, genders, sexualities, that comes from me meeting those people and talking, like being exposed to them. Is how I think that's how you get rid of bigotry. I think that's how you get rid of the fear of that is the fucking life force
Yeah.
of racism is by being exposed to different types of people and or just different experiences, you know?
Totally. Do you think you've been a critical thinker your whole life? In this
I do.
capacity?
I think. Not in nah, hell not, not not in this capacity. I mean, I think just like experience, lived experience adds to wisdom. It's not like wisdom is not book smarts. I think it's like you have to have lived through certain things to have to be wise about them, you know? Because it's a different type of knowing. It's like knowing in your stomach and not knowing in your head. I think like, yeah, I could, you know, I was like the kid, I always like to say is like I didn't need to go to prison. Oh, it wasn't a place I didn't want to be at. But I got friends that had to do that. You know, like they had to go see that ain't the shit that they need to be in. So I think that's part about critical thinking. But I don't think that my levels was, I don't think that, I have what I got now because I could only have gotten certain levels of knowledge through experience, basically. You know what I'm saying? So I think I am a critical thinker, but I think as I get older, I get better at it because I didn't see more and I didn't live more and I didn't met people smarter than me, you know, and I'm picking up stuff as I go. But I do think I've always been a person that assesses like situations and I watch people around me and to learn. Not so much to harm them or like to get an upper hand, but to learn. I'm a student of human nature, and I think all artists are. That's what I think. That's what art is. I think that's what we're doing. Is a master class in the science of people. You know what I mean? And so like, I think you got to be. I think to be like you were saying, good art or to be a good artist, like that critical thinking got to be there. You know what I'm saying? Because it's a level of vulnerability. You going at yourself and taking yourself apart, and then you putting it out for people to look at, right? So shit. If that ain't critical thinking, I don't know what is. You critically thinking about your experiences in your life, and then you putting them out for the world to see. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think that you gotta be You gotta have that to be good at it or to add anything to the conversation.
Definitely. Yeah. Well, Damon, thanks for taking this time and to do this. I really appreciate you for taking this time out of your day. And I generally end on one question, and although how serious the conversation has been, I'm just gonna ask it. But what it's gonna kind of give it a little bit of a spin. But so what advice do you have for artists and creatives?
Oh, be a fucking critical thinker. You know what I'm saying? Think about what you're doing and why you're doing it. Like, art is not entertainment, right? I like for me, it's a sacred practice. It's like being like in the older culture, it's like being a scribe or the shaman. That you like you're a spiritual guide with what you do. You can be if you truly aware. Like we one of the few professions that we can shift the hearts and minds of individuals and whole societies, right? So that's not a fucking joke. It's not something to play with. It's something that we should be aware of, and we should hold it sacred, and we should care about what we're doing. You know, and the way you do that is being critically thinking about the messages you're putting out in the world. I ain't saying censor yourself or take it, like do the Mr. Rogers stuff, which is, shout out to Mr. Rogers, but you don't got to be, it don't got to be butterflies and roses all the time either. Yeah. But understand that the energy you put out because of the talent you got amplifies. Like, and so just understand what you're doing with it. And I think that critical thinking piece is how you navigate that. It's how you navigate that power that we've been given and the platform that we've been given. Cause I do think it's important.
Yeah, I know. I completely agree. All right, man. Well, thanks for doing this.
Yeah, man. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate it. And, I do want to say, if anybody listening is in Oakland on Juneteenth, please come check out my next Darker God show, Lake of Dreams, at Betty Ono Gallery, downtown Oakland. And also, if you're in Detroit, June 4th, I got a show at Mocha, filling in the cracks. So I definitely did want to get that little shameless plug in, because, I will like to see how they see how critically I'm thinking.
No, yeah. No, I'll definitely reiterate that in the intro too. So yeah. And I'll make sure to direct people to where to find your work and everything.
Right on. I appreciate it, man. I really do. It's been our third talk, and they get better. They get better as they go.
Yeah, no, definitely, man. I definitely would like to have you again on, whenever you have shows or whatever, just, keep on promoting you and your work. And, like I said, I thank you for taking this time, man.
Right on, man. You too. Right. I appreciate you.
All right. Appreciate you too, man. All right.
Peace, peace.
Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, a.k.a. Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Noah Wainwright. YouTube and creative support is by Tyler Scully. Thanks so much for tuning in. See you next time.